that's a good sign. Anyway, I want to let you know what the rest of the week looks like after tonight. So tomorrow night, we have Ned in the Dirt. And if you remember, he's Meg Bonhouse's son and Emily's husband. And that should be an awesome show, a little rocking. And then Thursday night, we have the School of Rock, which is always a fabulous show. It's a fun show with all our kids. They're practicing only for 4 days, and they get to do a concert. So they're all excited, and the kids all come, and it's a fun night. So tonight, we have Lee Knight, and he's locally from Cullowhee. And he plays, you know, kind of all over the world and all kinds of instruments. And it's going to be a very fun evening. So please give a warm SUUSI welcome to Lee Knight.
Lawrence always said this last verse was his favorite. that last verse over again, and I want to line it out like the old-time music teachers used to. Would you sing that verse with me? It's a wonderful verse. Let's sing it together. Won't you come by the hills? There's a land where legends remain. Won't you come by the hills? There's a land where legends remain. Stories of old, they are told and told yet again. Stories of old, they are told. All the cares of tomorrow can be till this day is done. And all the cares of tomorrow can wait till this day is done.
Thank you.
go to one of my favorite Woody Guthrie songs. I really enjoyed the song that I heard this afternoon of Los Gatos Canyon. And so many of Woody's songs, sadly in some ways, are still ring true today. This one's about the outlaw Pretty Boy Floyd. If you'll gather round me, children, story I will tell about Pretty Boy Floyd the outlaw. Oklahoma knew him well. It was in the town of Shawnee on a Saturday afternoon. His wife beside him in the wagon as into town they rode. Well, a deputy sheriff approached them in a manner rather rude, using vulgar words of language, and Miss Floyd, she overheard. Well, Pretty Boy grabbed a lock chain, and the deputy grabbed a gun, and in the fight that followed, he laid that deputy down. Well, he took to the trees and timbers of that Canadian river shore. Soon every crime in Oklahoma was added to his door. It was on a Christmas morning in Oklahoma City. It was on a Christmas day. Came a whole carload of groceries with a message that did say, well, you say that I'm an outlaw and you say that I'm a thief. Well, here's a Christmas dinner for the families on relief. As through this world I ramble, I've seen lots of funny men. Some will rob you with a six gun and some with a fountain pen. As through this world I ramble, and as through this world I roam, I ain't never seen an outlaw drive a family from their home. Pretty Boy Floyd.
I'm going to sit down.
These folks at Western have done a great job with us here. I've already done this one twice today, but it's one of my favorite songs, and I'd love to tell the story that goes with it. This is another one of our old Appalachian folk songs, Shady Grove. Wonderful song for a hot week like we're having. But the story that goes behind it, I play occasionally with a world music trio called Woman and Friends, capital W, capital M-A-N. Some of you may have heard of her. She's a member of Yo-Yo Ma's Silk Road Ensemble. She plays with the Kronos String Quartet a lot, the Tokyo String Quartet. I heard her with the New York Philharmonic, along with Yo-Yo Ma and some other musicians. Fantastic musician. And we have a trio called Woman and Friends. James Mpubia from Uganda is our third member. And what she wanted to do was put together stringed instruments from different cultures. So we did a two-week tour of China in October, and somebody had chosen the songs for me to sing off of my CDs. And one of the songs that they chose was The Ballad of Queen Jane. Well, this is not the Ballad of Queen Jane that many of you know from Joan Baez. This is another one that's only been recorded three times, once by Sarah Cleveland, once by Sarah Cleveland's granddaughter, and once by me. And it's a ballad of incest and rape, which is why it hasn't been recorded very often. And I didn't think that was a particularly good song to sing in China, not knowing enough of the culture. So instead, I decided to do Shady Grove.
It's one you can help me out on.
Your part goes, Shady Grove, my true love, Shady Grove, my own, Shady Grove, my true love, along with the Shady Grove. Shady Grove, my true love, Shady Grove, my own, Shady Grove, my true love, along with the Shady Grove. Let's try it. Shady Grove, my true love, Shady Grove, my own, Shady Grove, my true love, along with the Shady Grove. First time I seen my Shady Grove, standing by the door, shoes and stockings in her hand, and a little bare feet on the floor. Shady Grove, my true love, Shady Grove, my own, Shady Grove, my true love. I love you in the winter time, I love you in the spring. Hurry home, sweet Shady Grove, and hear my banjo ring. I love you in the summertime, I love you in the fall. Hurry home, sweet Shady Grove, and love you most of all. Shady Grove, my little love, Shady Grove, my own. Shady Grove, my little love, along with Shady Grove. Shady Grove, my true love, Shady Grove, my own, Shady Grove, my true love, along with the Shady Grove. I wish I had a big fine horse, born to feed him on, for a little girl to stay at home and feed him when I'm gone. Shady Grove, my true love, Shady Grove, my own.
His father, Leonard, is in the third Foxfire book, if any of you are familiar with the Foxfire books. Sadly, Clifford passed away a couple of years ago, and sadly, he was also at the end of the line. So these instruments, I just love that banjo. But this dulcimer, too, he made this for me in 1978. The top of it is wormy chestnut. Many of you know the story of the chestnut. At one time, the predominant hardwood tree of the eastern forest, one of every four trees in the southern Appalachians was a chestnut. And the blight came in the early 1900s and wiped them out. And the chestnut was a hardy tree. After it died, it might stay standing for a few years, and the same thing happened to it. It's going to happen to you and I in a while. That is, the worms crawled in, the worms crawled out, they crawled all over and all about, and you got wormy chestnut. Back in 1978, Clifford and I could afford it. Today, probably neither one of us could. Lovely dulcimer. We're going down to Memphis, Tennessee. Sitting in the living room of W.A. Walter Furry Lewis. Furry was one of the early bluesmen that was recorded back in the early 1900s. He had a solo career, and he also played with some of the jug bands that played around Memphis. Made a bunch of recordings, and then the Depression hit, and he disappeared. Well, he didn't disappear. He knew where he was. But back in the 60s, when the folk boom took off, people went looking for him, and sure enough, there he was, a street cleaner, Memphis, Tennessee. He went on to have another career with his music. He was in a movie with Burt Reynolds. The Rolling Stones loved him. He opened concerts for them on occasion. Joni Mitchell went by to visit him, and it didn't sound like a good visit based on the song she wrote. So we're sitting in the living room. It's a nice sunny afternoon in Memphis, Tennessee. It's a shotgun kind of house. It's a dusty road and a dusty yard. Some of the neighbors have come in. They heard somebody's come to listen to Furry sing. His woman's there taking care of things. Jack is being passed around. Mr. Daniels to some of you. Furry looked up at me and he said, "You want to hear Casey Jones?" I said, "Yes, sir." Woke up this morning, it was 4 o'clock. Case you told the fireman, get your boiler hot. Put on your water, put on your coat. Put your head out the window, see my driver roll, see my driver roll. Put your head out the window, see my driver roll.
10 o'clock. Mr. Casey's children on the doorstep crying. Mama, mama can't keep from crying. Papa got killed on the southern line, on the southern line. Papa got killed on the southern line. Spread the news, Memphis women don't wear no shoes. I got a message on the back of my shirt, says I'm a natural born Eastman. I don't gotta work, I don't gotta work. Natural born Eastman, I don't gotta work. Came for about 10 years in the 70s and then just disappeared. And came back and the world had changed. But not everything. I've had some requests for some songs I completely forgot about. If the person who asked me for Barbara's song is here, I went home, played it, and just broke down sobbing. So I'm not going to play that one. Barbara is my one and only true lost love. Yeah, that one hurt. But I think I can manage to put this one together. This is a song that I started writing it when I was working in the civil rights movement down in Sumter, South Carolina. And I was sitting in my apartment. I had a room at the end of the building. And you went down the hall to my kitchen, and then further down the hall to the bathroom I shared with a guy at the other end of the hall. All this for $50 a month, payable to the woman who owned the funeral home next door. And you had to go through the funeral rooms to pay her. Got used to bodies. This one's called Ring Out the Bells.
Bells ring in towns as people go playing.
spring. Ring out the bells of the morning, I ring. Ring out the bells of the nighttime, ring too. Ring out the bells across rivers and mountains. Ring out the bells, they are ringing for you. Bells ring in churches as people go praying, searching for something, though not always. This one is made out of sourwood. It was made by a craftsman up in the Virginia, Tennessee area around Bristol. In the early days, this would have been an animal gut string, but what it is a guitar string I'm hoping will hold together for one more play. We didn't sound check this one, but it's easy. Thank you. I learned the answer to the age-old question of how do you get to Carnegie Hall? To learn to play the mouth bow. This is one of the instruments I play with Uman's group. Isn't this beautiful? This is the banjo Clifford Glenn made for me back in 1998. It's made out of black walnut. Isn't that gorgeous? Yeah. Beautiful, beautiful instrument. The head is made out of goatskin. He used goatskin because it's more resistant to humidity. The banjo also came to us from Africa and came over here during slavery time, came up into the mountains, and the mountain people fell in love with it. And one of the interesting things about the banjo is the mountain dialect, they'll put ER onto nouns. Window becomes winder. Potato becomes tater. Tobacco becomes backer. Mm-hmm. Well, the banjo becomes banjer. And the thing that's unique about it is in parts of West Africa, that's what this instrument is called, the banjer. So it's in that, don't you just love those ironies in language? They're just so much fun. Yeah. So,
let's see, what kind of tuning do we have? I haven't killed anybody yet, right?
No.
So we're going to kill off Pretty Polly.
Food and learn to return to go home.
Polly, pretty Polly, come go on with me. Polly, pretty Polly, come go along with me. Left no one behind. Of the wild birds to mourn.
Well, I don't know how well you can see this where you are, but isn't it pretty? This is a Cherokee flute. It's made out of a plant called river cane. River cane is a member of the bamboo family. It was an important plant to the Cherokees. They did a lot of things with it. One of the things they would do is they'd slice it lengthwise and cover it with mud and clay, wattle and daub. Some of you will know that building construction. And that's what they used to build their winter house with. Contrary to popular opinion, Floridians were not the first people to have second homes up here. The Cherokees were. They built their summer home right beside their winter home. And it was made of four poles with a roof and one side covered, made out of river cane. Many a Cherokee boy, his first weapon would be a blowgun made out of this plant that he'd used to hunt small animals with. One of the most amazing uses of this plant, and it still goes on today, although at one time they were down to only three women who knew how to do it. But Cherokee women to this day, using a double weave process, make watertight baskets out of this plant. They're absolutely beautiful. They're also absolutely expensive, which is why I don't have one to show you. And then they'll decorate them. They'll color some of the slats with the red color of the bloodroot, the yellow color of the shrub yellow root, and the brown and black colors coming from black walnut, the oaks. Another thing the Cherokees did is they decorated everything they made. So this was made by George Goins, a Cherokee woodcarver, and when he made this, he decorated it with these strands of rawhide with beads on it, beadwork, an important part of the Cherokee culture. And then the fur on the end of this, I suspect, is rabbit fur. And one of the things I like about my Cherokee flute, it's the only musical instrument I have that I can pet. You're in the land of the Cherokees. In fact, there were at least two villages on this campus. This morning I was singing over at the store, and part of that building was where the village was, and then student center. And in front of one of the dorms, there used to be a 75-foot, the word has escaped me. I've reached that age where words disappear every once in a while. 75-foot mound. And if I had known it, I did my graduate work in that building, and if I had known there'd been a mound out there before, I would have been more entranced with what I was doing. But as I say, a couple villages here on the area. So what I'm going to do now is just play for you three Cherokee flute tunes, and after one of them, I'm going to tell you the story of how these mountains were created. You may have heard some scientific stuff, like continents banging together. We're going to tell you the true story. In the beginning, according to the Cherokees, the earth was covered with water, and it was suspended by four cords to an arch in the sky, and the cords were the north, the south, the east, and the west. And the Cherokees believed that one day these cords will break and the earth will descend into water. Well, up underneath the sky arch was a platform where the animals lived, and after a while there got to be so many animals on the platform that it got to be too crowded. So they said to the water beetle, "Y'all know that bug that skates on the water?
They said to the little water beetle, go down onto the water and see if you can find land. So the little water beetle jumped down and was skating across the water but couldn't find any land. Finally, it dove down below the surface, and when it came up, it brought some mud with it. As the mud came up, it spread out, creating a great big landmass. Well, this landmass has been underwater for millions of years. It was very wet, and so they said to the great vulture, with your big wings, go down and dry the land. So the great vulture flew off, was flying around, drying the land, but there was a lot of land. It was very wet. It was taking a long time. Until finally the great vulture reached the land of the Cherokee, the land where you are this week. And as it got here, its wings began to get tired, and they began to dip and to sag, until finally they began to hit the ground. And where the wings hit the ground, it scooped up the valleys, and all the soil it picked up created the hills and the mountains, the land of the Cherokee, the land you're visiting this week. So much easier to play tectonics. One more song. Anybody have any questions you'd like to ask before I do a song? Any questions? Anybody have any answers? You're Unitarians, I'm sure you have that. Yeah.
How many instruments do you play?
That's subject to interpretation. I have a bunch. this is everything right here, I think. Yeah, I do play some Cherokee drums and rattles. Yeah, when I do more Cherokee stuff. I live right here in Cullowhee, 5 minutes away.
Right.
Yeah. That's why I can't come to SUUSI this week. I'm going to be guiding on the Nantahala River tomorrow. Don't you feel sorry for me?
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Can you come back?
I would love to come back.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Well.
And I would love to come to your church or your music society or whatever, and I don't even need to make a profit. Yes, ma'am.
You said you got your graduate degree from here. What did you get your degree in?
I got my degree in counseling. Yeah. Yeah. Don't get your degree here. Actually, this is a wonderful school. The program I had was very, very easy. But they've got a lot of wonderful programs here at Western, and they have a great library. You can find me every day in the wintertime in the library. I'm going to have a book coming out pretty soon. I worked with a wonderful woman named Marjorie Lansing Porter, who collected songs up in the Adirondacks beginning in 1940. And I've been editing her collection. We worked together for 3 years until she died in 1974. And the book got accepted by the University of Tennessee Press, and hopefully we'll have it out in about a year and a half. It's going to be a popular book, a book about folk songs of the Adirondacks. It's going to sell, I don't know, 300-400 copies. It'll go along with my Adirondack CD. I have an Adirondack CD I made from the collection, and I sell 2 to 3 copies of it every year. Do you know the market for unaccompanied lumber camp and iron mining songs? Pretty low.
It's terrific, though. Everybody should get it. I bought 2 copies.
Ah, well, my quote is made for the year. You remember that wonderful quote from Thoreau when he got his remainders from a week on the Concord Merrimack River? I have 500 books in my library, 475 I wrote myself.
Well, I'm going to sing one more song, and we'll call it a night. And I think the song I would like to close with, I'd like to take us down to the Sea Islands of South Carolina. I did this one this afternoon, but I'm going to do it again. Because it's a good song to close with, and I did the Pete song for you on Sunday. So, although you can always repeat Pete, right? Couldn't resist that. When I graduated from college back in 1967, I was given the opportunity to work in the civil rights movement in the state of South Carolina. And I worked and lived in a black community for 6 years. And I got some wonderful opportunities. I got to hear Duke Ellington's orchestra play his sacred concert. Duke Ellington was still conducting at South Carolina State College, they call it then, it's the university now. And I got to go down to the Moving Star Hall on Johns Island, South Carolina. Moving Star Hall was a combination church and burial society. And it was a very small building, and they had a wonderful way of singing. This is part of the Gullah culture, a culture that emerged on the Sea Islands at the end of the Civil War. At that time, nobody wanted to live in the Sea Islands. They were horrible places, hot, humid, bug-infested, disease-ridden. Hilton Head, Peoria, Cumberland, horrible places. And as a result, newly freed slaves moved out there. They established this culture known as the Gullah culture, and they had a wonderful way of singing their hymns. It's a shout style. But I'm not going to do a shout style because it takes lots of people. But I'm going to close with taking one of the shout songs and singing it as a spiritual. The woman I worked with down there was a wonderful woman named Janie Hunter. And Mrs. Hunter, you know, in those days, no electricity, hot and humid. The best place to be when you weren't working was out on the porch where the breeze blew. And whenever I sing this song, I can see Mrs. Hunter sitting on the porch singing this song. And as she sang it, you could have sworn she was talking to God. It's got one of the most powerful lyrics I know in music. You can buke me, meaning you can rebuke me. You can buke me. You can scorn me, you can scandalize my name, but my soul's got a seat up in the kingdom, and that's all right. It's been a joy to be with you again. Hush, little baby, don't you cry. You know your mama was bound to die, but my soul's got a seat up in the kingdom, and that's all right. That's all right, that's all right, that's all right, that's all right, cause my soul's got a seat up in the kingdom, and that's all right. Well, you can rebuke me, you can scorn me, you can scandalize my name, but my soul's got a seat up in the kingdom, and that's all right. And that's all right, that's all right, that's all right, that's all right. Cause my soul's got a seat up in the kingdom, and that's all right. One of these mornings, won't be long, you call my name, but I'll be gone, cause my soul's got a seat up in the kingdom, and that's all right, and that's all right, that's all right, that's all right, that's all right. My soul's got a seat up in the kingdom, and that's all right. Thank you very much. seeing all these things down here with my name on them. No, they'll be thrown away in a half hour. Well, let's do the song we did Sunday. By now you know it, so I know you'll sing it a little louder. Pete Seeger was a wonderful person, and I was very grateful to know him a little bit. One of my great memories of my life was sitting on the deck of the Clearwater. Pete was talking to me about Woody Guthrie and sharing the unrecorded verses of This Land Is Your Land. And again, Pete wrote the melody, the chorus, the first verse, the last verse. I wrote the second and the third verse, and your chorus goes, well, may the world go, the world go, the world go. Well, may the world go.
Take some music home. Get some music back to the church. Thank you, and we'll see you tomorrow night.